Okay, good afternoon, friends, students, countrymen. Okay, can't help it. Yeah. All right. So I'm really delighted to introduce Kartikeya Sarabhai. I will refer to him as Kartik Bhai. If I may sort of very briefly say, in some ways, the history of our country is encoded in his DNA. And that is not a trivial statement. Kartik Bhai was born in 1947. His grandfather was Ambalal Sarabhai, and his father was Vikram Sarabhai. Just now in PS College, when we were coming from the library, he stood in front of the write-up of his father, which is there as an eminent Indian. So that's something interesting that you should know. Vikram Sarabhai, as you may know, was a scientist, the founder of India's nuclear energy program and space program. Kartik Bhai himself is the founder and director of India's Center for Environment Education, headquartered in Ahmedabad. It has a reach into almost every school system in the country, and I think it's also interesting that one of the first places where I worked formally is Center for Environment Education, and absolutely delighted to meet Kartik Bhai after so many years and renew the connections. It was one of the really lovely spaces to work with, and meeting Santosh and now Harsh, it's like coming full circle in many ways. In addition to his work, Kartikeya Sarabhai is a prominent member of such international environmental organizations as the Earth Charter International Council and the International Union for the Conservation of Nature. He attended the 1992 Earth Summit in Rio de Janeiro and the 2002 Earth Summit in Johannesburg as a member of the Indian delegations. There are a number of very interesting things, but he himself requested that I don't go into all those details. If I've left something out, you might want to. But without much further ado, I will request Kartik Bhai to address you. Thank you.
Give me. Yeah, can you hear me? Yeah, great. So thank you, Indira, for that thing. And it's wonderful to be here, meeting friends and people who, some of them who I know were here, some who I didn't. We walked into the library, and he said, as a student, he heard me in the librarian, chief librarian in Ahmedabad. So it was nice to again connect, and what a wonderful opportunity you have to study here. What I was going to do today was share a few ideas on education, and these come out of the fact that while so many institutions are changing rapidly, education, because of the type of inertia it has, and it's going to have, because there are teachers who have studied how to teach maybe 20 years ago, there are very few ongoing in-service programs. The technology is changing so rapidly. When C was started, I remember having to argue with my colleagues why we need a computer. The fax machine then arrived. Internet was not there. The internet then arrived. And you can just imagine for people now who take all these for granted, that of course the mobile phone, how we even operated without that. But we did. The world did. But it changed. I think after Gandhiji passed away, after he was shot, they actually saw how rapidly the remotest part of this world, remotest part of India, got to know that information. And it was within hours. It was within hours, just through the fact that the information was so important that people passed it on from one to another. And it reached them without having any of these phone connections and other things. When I was at university, I remember from Cambridge, I would write a letter to my mother, and I would have to count 18 days by the time that her reply would come. It would come exactly on the 18th day, but it would take 18 days to come. And to talk to her on the phone, we had to pre-arrange a time when I would be near a phone booth to be able to do it. So I mean, just if you think of the dramaticness in which things change, and we take it for granted so fast, Today, when we are late somewhere by 10 minutes, we say, oh, you know, this is what, not remembering that just a few years ago, that same act might have taken several hours to do. And even what we are taking for granted now, in another couple of years, you will forget that this was the way it was, and it is changing. So the question which I have been asking always is, how come our education system is relatively changing much slower than the way the world is changing? And at some stage, will it just be that the whole thing will collapse in the sense of the need for having a formal degree or a formal this thing? It'll just learn, collapse into something where everyone feels that, look, I can learn independently, I can be certified independently, and I get my jobs without necessarily having to go through the same sort of formal education system? Or will the formal education system itself change fast enough to keep pace with these changes? And in that, over these years, we've learned many, many lessons. And I thought what I'll do is I just wrote down some key ones which I thought I will share with you today, and how my learning also happened from that. And let me just start taking you through some of that. I wanted to start by looking at a simple mathematics sum. I'd gone to, I used to teach in a school just outside Ahmedabad, about 45 minutes out of Ahmedabad. And it was a rural school. It was third standard or second standard students. And it was a particularly simple sum. And I did that, and I went around asking people what was the answer to this sum. And it was interesting that the entire class had only four answers. There were not many answers, there were only four answers. And I just went down one by one, and we were writing, and there were all these answers which were there, but there were only four answers. And the teacher was most upset that someone from Ahmedabad had come from, and it was looking so bad on her that very few people actually got the answer right. And we were looking at it. Now, this, of course, all of you can make out what happened here. What did they do? They added. So that was something which is understandable. Now, what did these children do? There were a whole lot of children who got that answer. So what do you think they did? You're not allowed in there. Yeah, say it. No, they didn't do that. First of all, they don't know X. First of all, they don't know this thing stands as X.
They multiplied first digit, like 5 into 5, 25, and they added 2 and the carry.
Correct. So what she's got is right. They multiplied 5, 5, 25, carried 2. They did 2 plus 2, 4. They didn't do the second multiplication. This is what they did. The third answer which anyone got was that. Now, what did these kids do? Yeah. So they did the opposite of these kids. They did the opposite of these people. They multiplied the second time, but didn't carry. They didn't carry. And then you had, of course, the correct answer, children. So it was very intriguing that there were only these four answers in the whole classroom. Now, all the children had slates. So there was no way of storing the data or seeing it later. You know, there were slates. So they would, after you do, you erase it, so you don't have the data. Teacher herself was amazed that there were only four answers. She said, nay, because very few got this. Another interesting thing was that the 125s were all clustered. So it wouldn't be a random 125. So 125 here, 125 there, 125 there. So of course I asked the children, what's happening? So they know that if I want to do this, I have to sit next to Indira because she knows the right answer. So in each of those clusters, there's actually only one true 125. The rest are all copying from the person they knew who got the right answer. So very, very fast we could make out that there were like so many children in the classroom who knew this. Now, luckily, there were only four, and the classroom has this thing. So what I said was, okay, all the 30s go into this place, this corner. All the 45s gather here, 105s, and the true 125s, you go and teach these people what was going on wrong. So the teacher was amazed that all this was going on in the class. She was sitting there, and they got it. And then she said, now she gave another multiplication of another thing, and they got that also right. So she said, but you taught this. And what she used to do was, if you got 25 into 5 wrong, she would make the entire class get up and say the tables of 5. That was her method. Now, actually, not a single child had made a mistake on tables of 5. Every child had the tables of 5 correct. So she could not understand why, when I got everyone to get up and say tables of 5, the problem is not getting solved, because all of their problems was to do with the process. The process was the problem. They knew their tables backwards because they were all remembered. So suddenly, the minute the process, these children have said, "Acha, we have to multiply second time and then add." You know, once they got that in their head, all their answers started coming correctly. And you saw a complete transformation in the classroom. Now, this was something which taught me a lot of things here. When I first did this, and then I went on to other experiments on this, that very few people or very few children make a random error. They don't make random errors. So we treat children by saying, okay, inko nahi aa raha hai. It's not that they nahi aa raha hai. They are operating through a different rule. They've got a logic. But their logic is different. I have a grandchild who loves planes. And he wrote that on, he made a model plane and he wrote that. So first I couldn't figure out why was he doing that. Now what he was actually doing was that the Airbus 380. He had learned only numbers up to 10. So the number 80 was not there. But he had learned ABCD. So he, poor chap, just assumed that 380 is this. He knew 380. But 380 is this. This is what he thought. Okay, now it is very easy to just ignore this data is coming to me. The minute the child is writing this, some data is coming to me. You know, the child is listening very correctly. He's not written 38. He could have written E also perhaps, but he has not written anything. It's not a random error. It is an error based on his judgment at that time of what it is. And he wrote 38T instead of 380. So the whole approach of really trying to understand the children and understand that this is, that children all use logic. In fact, not only children, adults use logic. And we don't understand the logic, and so the power equation in any situation then determines what is correct and what is wrong. It is purely a power equation. So in one of the classes I did, the answer was three, and this child enthusiastically got up and says tain. Now for those who might know Gujarati, tain is a very rural colloquial way of saying three. So the teacher said wrong. It was only this pronunciation, which was very rural, but he was put down. Instead of Tran, which is the way I would say it in Ahmedabad. Now, if the capital or the power base was actually his village and not Ahmedabad, all the Ahmedabadis would have to be saying Tain. Because there is nothing intrinsically correct in language about one way of saying it and another way of saying it. And in fact, the English language is so powerful, and one of the reasons of its success is its inclusivity. It sees a new word, people start using it. Mr. Trump uses the wrong word. Before you know it, it gets into the dictionary. Because they're saying language is not correct and wrong, it is to do with usage. If everyone uses the word selfie, selfie deserves to be in the dictionary. You can't say selfie is wrong. Today in, for instance, CNN, they say, just like you say, take a look. They say, take a listen. Take a listen. Now in Indian English or English, we don't say take a listen. Listen to this or something. We don't say take a listen. But in American English, they say take a listen. So that becomes correct. And something else becomes not acceptable. So to understand the relativeness of what is right and what is wrong, and it comes out of this. Because if I had, in that mathematics sum, if this symbol had just been turned by 45 degrees, the answer 30 would have been correct, in fact. Because then the symbol would have meant plus rather than multiplication, and it would have meant meant something completely different. So what we were looking at was this perspective thing. I should tell you another small story. We have a woman who comes and does, there's a little puja in my place. And there was the woman who came and arranged the flowers before you lit the lamp. And the flowers always faced outwards. And this was it. Then that day she was on leave. And this other woman from a very rural background in UP also did the same thing. But all her flowers were facing the other way. So this first woman by this time comes in. And she says, what an idiot, don't you know how to arrange the flowers and et cetera, et cetera. And scolded her. And that woman just listened to it. Because in the power equation, she was lower down from this other woman and had to listen to it. Now I, being who I am, didn't let it go like that. So I called her and I said, what did you do? Now for the first woman, the flower was a decoration, an abhushan, and therefore faced outwards. For the second woman, it was an offering. And because it was an offering to God, it faced God, faced the image rather than faced you. Now they're perfectly good logics. The two logics were perfectly good. In one case, it was an abhushan. The other case, it was an offering. And therefore, it faced inside. But the woman who completely used her power to say, ke, galat kiya hai, aisa nahi karna hai, she has missed that whole thing. Like the person who says, 380 wrong hai. You know, I could have well said, it's wrong. But instead of that, I'm trying to understand the child. So the whole idea of understanding was one of the things which came about in this whole search for education. Now the reason I spent this much time on it is to say that we were wondering how do we now get this into the school system, because the teacher has a slate, they don't have time, they don't have something. And I was thinking, for instance, in maths, we are trying to start something where I'm saying that any person anywhere in India can email to a diagnostic center any problem. And sometimes to solve the problem, why that person has made a mistake might take a couple of hours. But you can find out, and I have yet not come across random errors. It's incredible how systematic it is. Now again, something which is possible in today's context. I want to move to another one, which is what do birds eat? So this child, in friend's child, was asked in the class, what do birds eat? Child was a bit excited, what do birds eat? He said, birds eat cows. Huh? So there was a response like it was just now. And he said, you please meet me after class. That was the teacher's response, was please meet me after class. Because the textbook very clearly says what birds eat. You see, birds are eating grains and they are eating insects. This is what birds are supposed to be eating, and that's what they are eating. Okay? They are not supposed to be eating cows. But that was a time of drought in Gujarat. In fact, from that very window of that school, you could see dead cattle and you could see birds eating. The child had just been observing from the window that cattle were being eaten by the vultures, they were eaten by the crows, there were many other birds which were eating it. And the answer was in fact correct, that some birds do eat cows, right? So, but it was wrong. In that case, we had also sometimes have to go and talk to the teacher what happened. But this is one of the problems, that the child learns very quickly that what is truth is something else. I just put a slide together this morning from Professor Yashpal, who passed away last week. And I just was in remembering him, because one of the things he said in this national curriculum framework was that the transaction of teachers also learns if the child is not forced to remain passive, since children usually perceive and observe more than grown-ups. Their potential role as knowledge creators needs to be appreciated. I mean, it's a very this insightful thing, and in fact, that whole curriculum report, if you have a look at it, is full of wonderful things about the education system in India and what we need to do, and some of the things which we are talking about. And why is it that as children grow up, we have to start asking them that how come they are not asking questions? So then later on you will have a faculty meeting saying not enough people are asking questions. How do we do it? How do we raise curiosity? And it's like some people come to me and saying, "Acha, you're growing a beard." So I said, no, I'm not growing the beard. You are cutting it. The growing is automatic. You see? It's the wrong question. Am I growing a beard? No, I'm not growing a beard. I don't do anything for growing my beard. You spend time shaving it. Because the growing is automatic. Similarly, asking questions is automatic. It comes with the system. When the child is born, It is a feature of the system to ask questions. What we do in our early years of tri-school is that please don't ask these questions of what birds eat and all this nonsense. Please stick to what the textbook says. And the textbook is what the final answer is. So sometimes we put the problem wrong. My own son went from a regular school to something else. And he was asked how many continents that there were. Now at that time, they've corrected it later, but the Gujarat textbook said 8. Now the 8th one was the Arctic, which is up here. Now Arctic is in fact a frozen piece of ice. There's no landmass on it. So today we do not consider it a continent. We consider it's a floating piece of ice, and thanks to climate change, it might not be there also in later years. But today it is still there. So this was the thing. So he came back home and I said, why don't we? We knew the class, our correct answer was 8. But we wrote 7. I goaded him to write 7. So of course he got it wrong and he came back that evening. He said, Papa, this was wrong. So I said, how can you allow that to happen? So we took in 3 atlases, Reader's Digest Atlas, some other books, etc., put some slips in it, made the poor child carry the whole books to the class. Then he comes back that evening. He says, Papa, they might be right or wrong, but can I do my schoolwork on my own? If you want to teach me, you can do it on Sunday. But schoolwork, I know how to answer the school question. So he learns very early on, as a small kid of 10 years or 11 years, how to pass. That the school is like a system. It's like a game. Like when you play football, at least in India, you're not supposed to hold it with your hand. If you play football in America, you are supposed to hold it with your hand and run, you know. So anyway, if you're playing something else, you're supposed to kick it. In something else, you're supposed to catch it. So there are rules. So similarly, the classroom rules are write what the textbook is and write what they think is the correct answer. Forget what the correct answer might be. How do parliamentarians behave? Now, if you start writing from what you saw on the TV last night, you'll be thrown out, you know. You cannot write that. How do civic officials behave? So the point was that the other thing which the education system was doing was that it starts alienating you from the environment. You know, it first of all, it tells you that truth has to be defined in terms of the rules of the system. Secondly, it does not respect the fact that you have a logic when you come. When you give a wrong answer, in fact, the wrong answer tells me more than the right answer. In any situation, if you give a wrong answer, it tells me because your mind has worked to something. It's not giving you just a random wrong answer. So it tells me something. So how do I do that? Children are also often able to solve problems. So one of the things we wanted to try was how do we get children to solve their own problems and with their own logic. So assuming that every child has a logic, how do they do it? I have two granddaughters, and there is this Matryoshka Russian dolls. As you perhaps know, one goes into another, and there are 7. Not easily, but everyone, both of them like this smallest one. So the fight would every time be to who gets the smallest one. And somehow getting me to intervene in that system, which was hopeless, because any way you do it, you are wrong. So there's no way of intervening. So I left it to them, and then they both came very happily and said, look, we worked it out. So I said, how have you worked it out? So they're saying that anyone who wants the smallest one gets 2 others. So they get totally 3. The other one gets 4. Okay, so now they've got a system of balancing. So again, you find that even in terms of observing, problem solving, doing logic, everything else, they have their own way of doing it. This other young boy here, who's the one in that other photograph, so he said, Papa, there's a lot of water being wasted when we wash our hands with soap. So because he puts it on, wets his hand, then he takes the soap versus the water is going around, and then he washes it. So he said, there's this waste. So I said, OK, how do you solve it? So then he thinks about it, and he comes back and says, what we should do is that 2 of us should go together into the bathroom, and one is soaping, the other is washing. Anyway, what I'm saying is that these might not be very, they are not necessarily solutions you do, but what is interesting is that they are the freshness of the solution. they are not burdened with so much ways of thinking that they can do it. And in fact, there was an article just yesterday, I read it on the plane, about Nobel laureates. And they were saying how many Nobel laureates actually came out of people who had cross fields. They're actually cross fields. So Francis Crick didn't start off being a molecular biologist. He started being a physicist. But because he goes into molecular biology, he doesn't know what are the right questions. He's not been indoctrinated into asking the right questions. And therefore, he can ask like a child. He can explore. He can ask fresh questions. And that freshness got him the answer. So sometimes we are so used to thinking of that this is the only way you do something that we are unable to break out of it and do it. And if people were saying how many of these things were in fact mistakes. Post-it, for instance, was a mistake. It was not meant to be that way. Something didn't stick properly. And then someone had the idea of saying, wow, you know, let's make it. Then you made a product out of it. But it was a mistake, as you know. And so on and so forth. Even if you say the internet and all of these things, how many of those inventions actually came out of mistake? And they come out of mistake by not losing that freshness of thought. Now, why is this related to that changing India? And the way it is related is this, that we are rapidly developing. We are one of the world's fastest growing large economies today. We all want to be developed. At the same time, we all understand that the paradigm model of development, which is, say, the West, America, Europe, or whatever it is completely unsustainable. In fact, I have another whole set of slides. I'm not showing it today. But if you were to suddenly go into that model of development, the whole world collapses because we just don't have. There is a thing called Earth, what's it called? The day when you use up your resources. Not Earth Hour. It just happened yesterday. No. This is that they calculate overshoot day. That's right. The Earth Overshoot Day is a way of calculating that by what date in the year you finish an annual set of things. And it used to be October, then it was September, and now I believe it, last few days it came about, it became August, 2nd August. So by August 2nd, you already used up your annual budget. And now you are going into fossils and other things. So what is that that we have? We have a situation where, yes, we want to develop rapidly. Secondly, what do we have? We have the fact that we have the entire experience of the developed countries of 200 years, 250 years since the Industrial Revolution. So you have that. They didn't have that when they went into decision making, they didn't have it. And you want to do it. But what do we not have? We have a colonial, which is bound to be a colonial certain education system and a colonial mindset. So it is very difficult to get something out of our own system where you can do something very different. Because it's very difficult, because it's completely hammered into our mind that this is the way things are done. And so how do you break out of that? How do you do new things? How does the school work? Now, if you see, again, how do children learn? You just go into a home situation, you know, they learn from each other. They talk. It's not a very disciplined atmosphere, but they learn extremely rapidly. Most people learn language that way. They're not taught their primary language. The mother tongue is not actually taught at that stage. The children learn it at a very early age from what they hear from each other. But in the classroom situation, we say, please look at the teacher. Please don't talk between you two. You know, that's how I approach you. Instead of encouraging, please talk. You know, please ask yourself each question. I say, don't talk. So you say, OK, next time I won't talk. So instead of the horizontal learning, first of all, just practically disappears. We now have sessions. I'm not saying it completely disappears. We have good universities, good colleges. They have it. But by and large, most schools will not allow learning to go from A to B. And like my maths example at the beginning, you will rarely find a fact that there is someone in the classroom who can assist me in that particular aspect. So you don't. You have the other aspect that you kill everyone's self-confidence. There is a very nice film actually from Karnataka where there's this classroom where, again, like that Tyne example, these children who come from the more tribal areas of Karnataka have faced such discrimination in the classroom and made fun of, that they start by saying, look, I don't know, I'm somehow inferior. So you kill confidence, you kill questioning, and then when they come up, some of them then come up, then you say, how do I get, like the beard, how do I get them to ask questions? Okay? So instead of saying that, look, you have, your system has really broken the back of that. So this was the thing, and when we were talking about all of these things, in 84, the Ministry of Environment was just coming up. If you remember, in 72 was the first major United Nations conference in Stockholm, Sweden. And that took place on June 5th, which is why till now we celebrate June 5th as World Environment Day. But June 5th was there, and the only prime minister or head of government from anywhere in the world who went there was Indira Gandhi. And she went there because, and she made that statement there, that you cannot solve problems of development without environment, poverty without environment, and environment without development. You cannot, these two are to be seen together. They're not contradicting each other. They're in fact reinforcing each other. They in fact reinforce each other. So this was just coming up, the ministry was coming up, and I along with certain colleagues, were busy with doing a number of small experiments. We were doing this, some school experiments, we were doing something with wildlife, we were having an interesting program on urban urban systems, why people move. We were looking at, for instance, why there is violence. I'd done a survey in those days in Ahmedabad of what is it that people want in this very far off year called 2000. At that time, 2000 was like science fiction, I'm telling you. When you said 2000, it seemed like just like if I were to tell you 3000 or something, you would think, yeah, you know, science fiction. So 2000 was very far away. But what do you want? And many of them said that at that time, Ahmedabad had an ability of having people, a woman can see a night theater and at midnight go on a scooter alone home or walk alone home without fear. And that has to be still there. And then we went and had the meeting with the planners and we said, look, we want this. He said, look, I've got my urban plan here. And he put it there and he said, you got this thing. Now, do you know the relationship between the two? What should be my, what is the implication of how I build my roads, how I build my road, what do I do on behavior of people? And if I don't know that relationship, how do I plan for it? So it's very interesting. And that's how we were looking at environment, meaning social environment. In fact, I never used the word environment initially to mean natural environment. I use the word environment to mean the environment of people and how in a city, the environment for women, we were specifically looking at, for a young woman, what is the environment in which they have to live? And that was the way I was actually using the word environment first. Now we, of course, use it in a much broader way. So that is when they asked us, and we said that it would need to set up something to do something like that. We wanted to set up. So that's how the proposal to set up the Center for Environment Education happened. In 83, we gave this proposal that we wanted to set up, and this, we felt, had to go along with all the other things you are doing. So you can pass good policies. You can have good technology. But ultimately, if you don't have education, it's not going to work. And therefore, education has to be one of the pillars of India's stand. And that is why we started. The other thing, we came to the conclusion that however big an institution might think, it is not even a drop in the ocean in the context of a country like India. And so the only way you can work is through partnership and through mobilizing a lot of other people who take it as their program. If it looks like CE's program or Government of India program, that's the end of that. So we have today programs done nationally. We have 40 offices. We work in every part of this, in every district almost of the country. This is a little advertisement, but if any one of you wants to work there or do an internship with CE anywhere in the country, this is all possible. I've already discussed with some of your seniors that this is obviously possible. So when we started that, we were looking at what was the difference in education that we were looking at. So we were saying that we need to move from teaching to learning. And there's a difference between learning, which is in many ways driven by yourself, rather than teaching, which has driven that. The whole movement now is on lifelong and continuous. And at that time, that was not such a common word, but today with the net and everything else, it's strange that you employ someone and you say that person will be employed till they are 60, let us say, 35, 40 years you are employing it, knowing that very technology and the very machine that they are working on is probably going to last only 10 years. You know, in one of the companies I was there, there was a person employed to be a telegraph operator. Now, she said that is my job and I refuse. And under the current labor laws, I couldn't get her to change it. She said, the fact that you don't send telegrams, I can't help it. But that is what my job is. You know, so now this is the sort of dilemma. Today, that cannot be the case. That just simply cannot be the case. We will not. Anything you learn now will seem outdated in another 10 years. So unless you learn to learn rather than learn about something. Learn about something you do need to do. But more importantly is learning how to learn, how to continuously learn. So that was another part of how our education system needs to change, not be a storehouse of data, because that is now outsourced into Google or whoever does it. But we need to do this. Multi-source and accessed, and that is a very interesting thing. Sometimes if I were to give a talk, and by mistake, if I give some facts, someone in the audience would have already checked it and said, sir, but this thing says something different. You know, so today one has access, sitting here without even going to the library, you have access on things which you never had before. Empowering rather than socializing. Now, the whole old education system was based on bringing you fit to be in the society. There was a society, you don't want people to break rules, you want them to socialize, essentially. Now you're talking about empowering because you know that society is not going to last perhaps in any case. You need to learn differently. When I was learning cricket, my coach spent a lot of time telling me how to do the first forward defense and how the ball should not even leave the mat. A Dhoni who comes out without any of that education, he basically knows he has to score runs. And the shot he hits is not anywhere in any of the books. At that time, today, of course, now you will say that it's become something. So again, it comes out of the fact that he didn't learn that technique. He learned there was something which came naturally. So how do you empower people to think freely? How do you think of global yet local specifics? It's very challenging because you're talking about climate change. Now, climate change is by definition a global problem. The plastics in the ocean, it's a global problem. It's not a local problem. And slowly, air pollution also, the whole cloud over China, it doesn't just create in China. It might just shift to another country. So how do you do that? And I'll come back to that. Capacity building, multidisciplinary approach. Very interesting, I was talking at NCRT and the CBSC syllabus. So that year, the CBSC syllabus defined sustainable development. Sustainable development was defined in the social studies textbook. Traffic. And in those things were in the science textbook. Now, the two are separate. They're two linked. There was no way I could ask questions on both. You know, so one is here, and all the things I need to do it is in the other one. So one of the recommendations I've done is still not accepted in the thing is that can we say that when I give a paper on one subject, I am allowed to put in one question from any of the other subjects which you are also studying. Is that allowed or not? Because otherwise, if you do it today, they'll say, but how did he ask this question? I was going to prepare for that day after tomorrow when that exam was there. Today, I'm not prepared for this. You know, this is the sort of answer. You will get a whole thing up. But can I ask a question which is different? Can I ask a question which is of last year? For example, can I go into a class 8 class and instead of giving the 8th standard question, can I ask a few questions from the 7th standard, few from the 6th and few from the 5th, you will find that people can't answer that. Because you're basically using your short-term memory often to regurgitate what answers you need. So how do you do that? How do you do multidisciplinary approach? And problems don't come in that way. You don't have a problem which is saying this is physics or this is chemistry. The problem is, in fact, multidisciplinary. And often when you talk about water problems, for instance, water problem, is it a hydrology problem? Is it a problem of natural systems? Is it a problem of soil erosion? Is it a problem of contamination? Is it chemistry? What is it? And unless you bring people together. So to what extent can you have disciplines coming together? And then how do you bring in the sensitivity to gender, diversity, and et cetera? It also happens, we were asked to look at textbooks of Gujarat at that time. Now, all the illustrations in that, of cooking, for instance, were all people standing up and women cooking on a counter. 80% of the women do not cook on a counter. They sit and cook. So already you are sort of, there's a hidden message being given there that this is the correct way of doing it and this is not. In fact, when the Gujarat Housing Board came up with this housing for women, for the poor, they made these counters. And many of the women didn't know what to do. Some of them sat on top of that counter, some of them sat underneath, some broke the counter, some made cupboards out of it. Because the person who passed it was some man sitting in some air-conditioned office who probably never cooked. And he passes the drawings. And then these people are living, never asked anyone. So how do you become sensitive? Of course, the easiest way is to talk and understand. And then participatory and based on learning with peers, I already spoke about that. So these were some of these things. But then there was another challenge. In 84, we started. 85, I was called to speak at the North American Association. What are the challenges? And I was just thinking, how do we develop a center which deals with India as a whole? Because everything is different. Anything I develop for, say, Karnataka, whether that same module on water can be used in Rajasthan. And you would say, how can you use it? Because, I mean, the rainfalls are completely different. People's habits are different. Storage ideas are different. So basically, the whole concept of having a national curriculum or a national teaching material itself is sort of not possible. So we were thinking, how do we design? And at that time, I happened to use an analogy of a sari. And I said, here is a sari is a garment which is highly designed. You know, it is a highly designed piece of cloth. In fact, the sari of, say, some of the saris might take even 2 years to make. Some of the patola sari, for instance, Gujarat, it costs 4 lakhs and takes 2 years. However, it doesn't come with a prescription. It doesn't come with a prescription, this is how you wear it. It's a tool. A sari is a tool garment. It's not like wearing an Armani suit, where if I wear it differently, I will feel that, look, what is the whole idea of buying something so expensive if I am finally going to change it around? But here is something which is a tool. So what we felt was that can we have a system whereby all the educational material which goes out, all the textbooks and everything else, are really tools in the hands of teachers which can be modified and done like I would do a sari or a dhoti or something, as opposed to something which comes with an absolute prescription of how to do it. So I should be able to change it around. And which is why one of the first fundamental things was that the capacity building of teachers. The teacher has to first of all feel that he or she is empowered to change things. The teacher is not. So that the teacher who heard a child say that the birds eat cows or that there are 7 continents, she did not feel empowered to say, yes, that is right. She could have. But she didn't feel empowered. In fact, in that case, I went to the teacher and asked them. I said, why can't you do it? So she says, Kartikeya, you know and I know that this is the correct answer. But the way the system works is that my class's answers will go to another teacher who I don't know, and they will examine it, and they will mark it wrong. So my class will all fail. So therefore, I have to tell them, although I know and they know, that this is the wrong answer, but this is the correct answer if you want to pass. Right? So this was a dilemma. So unless you change again that system somewhere, you can't. There is also the whole issue of right and wrong in the Indian system. There is a right answer. There's a concept of right answer in almost everything. And I had gone to, I was a bright student here. Then I went to Cambridge, and that first day some sum was given to me, and I thought, you know, nothing. I couldn't solve it. So I was supposed to present it next day to my tutor at 9 o'clock. I stayed up till, I think, 3 o'clock or something. I just couldn't solve it. I said, I just can't solve it. So the next day I went to the teacher. I said, sir, I can't solve this problem. He said, why not? He said, I need the specific gravity of stone. That one figure I don't have. Now, in India, we are used to all the things we need are given there. Everything we need is given. And in fact, they don't have a spare thing given also. You just try in any of your classes, just give students one data which they don't need in that sum. They will go into a complete loop because that spare screw or whatever it is, they think they have done something wrong. They do not have the confidence to say, okay, bhai, this is a spare bit of information. Just try it. Go to any classroom, take any sum, give one or two data which is not required at all in the sum, and see what happens. And it goes into this chakra, because unless I use it, I cannot. But the same thing, if I give one question, one thing less, I also have a problem. So he said, okay, what do you think it is? I don't know. So he said, do you think it's as much as lead? I said, surely not. Is it more than, I said, it's more than that. So he said, you solve it with both those things and say the answer is between this and this. Now in my entire education system in India, I have never heard of this concept that an answer can be in approximately between this and this. I have never heard that concept. But that is how the real world works. Because in the real world, all data is not in fact available to you. Only certain data is available, the rest you have to estimate. The whole concept of estimation, whole concept of going. So teacher training is a very much, we have a program called Green Teacher, and Santosh is going to run it. Now when CE started in 84, yes, there was interest. But basically when the Supreme Court of India ruled that every classroom in India has to have a component of environmental education. And when that happened, it completely changed why we were created. So we got a huge opportunity to work in that. And at the school level, we basically took two approaches. We took the eco club approach and the whole school approach. Now the whole school approach means that it has to fit into the classroom and has to meet to the curriculum. It's the same age children and everything else. But the club approach means you can do it in different ways. So we said we should play with both. And our objective was to not only make people aware and sensitize, but able to get knowledge, motivated through action. And in that, one of the things which comes up is this concept of ecological footprint. Now for those who have not heard about it, it was essentially an engineer, Swiss guy, a farmer's son, who thought that how do I give a number for my lifestyle? What does my lifestyle do to the world? So like a farmer thinks in terms of land, he said, let me convert my lifestyle into land. So I'm using so many kurtas or whatever out of cotton to grow that much cotton so much. I eat so many chapatis and rice so much. I do so many things. So basically it's a number, it's an artificial indicator number generated. Now the footprint institution is in California. And you can check your own footprint. You can go on the net. There are different footprint calculators. You can just put in your data and you will get footprint. So footprint is how much you are treading on the earth. Now, we were doing this project in Andhra in 2005 in St. Mary's School in Hyderabad, the 10-year-olds. And this girl comes and says, this whole class, okay, why is environment always taught in a negative thing? Why is environment something negative? We can also do things. We also have ideas. We also can do things. So they came up with a concept of the handprint. Handprint is what is the action towards this? What is the positive action I can do? And I said, I had gone to Hyderabad to see our office. I said, my God, what a wonderful concept. In 2007, we had an official UNESCO seminar. The DG of UNESCO had come to see, and this was launched at that time. Today, in several parts of the world, they are using the handprint. And I can tell you that there are very few symbols which started in India and are globally being used. This will be one of them. It started off with one school in Andhra. Little girl, this is the hands of a girl called Shrija. And I actually, when the Canadian television crew, they said, oh, we want to come and film Shrija. Because now she's an elder girl, she's in Vijayawada, I believe, in college and something. We want to do it. But phoned her parents, the parents said no. It'll spoil her studies, you know. So and unlike the form you got me to sign, without such a signed form, I cannot film her. So she doesn't know that her handprint has gone all over the world. She's somewhere there, but that's the way it is. But this was used by a number of people. They added meaning to it, and it is there. But it's becoming a symbol of a positive action. And we used that to create a program which was called Paryavaran Mitra. Paryavaran Mitra deals with these five areas: water, energy, waste, biodiversity, greening, culture, and heritage. And any school can join it. There's no sort of charge on the program. We had Abdul Kalam launched the program. We got corporates to help with it. And it was basically to go towards the whole school approach, which was to take the school as a whole. Because you cannot say that I deal with cleanliness, but my environment is not clean. In fact, if you were to go to the Ministry of Environment, the earlier one, and just look out of the window, you see the complete mess. Now I said, how does anyone believe you? There's not a, I was telling the secretary that time, there was not a single water drop drunk in that whole ministry, which didn't come from a big canister. I said, you are telling people all over the world to drink water which is clean and other things, but if you have to can only drink water coming in a canister, then obviously it doesn't make any sense, because you have that same thing. This was the time when people were linking education also to sustainable development, and the word ESD, Educational Sustainable Development, came up. So we started a lot of work connecting education for sustainable development. There's a climate change program there. In that, we also took people from villages to school, and we felt we had to connect. So that was another important thing. Here was one example of leaking taps on every drop, and actually the students frowned that half the taps they could, in fact, repair themselves. And then they do a little calculation how much water they save, farmers' projects. And so when you do all this, sorry, I'm going to move to something else here, that we found that we are doing this. Now, this is another idea which is there, that the whole idea of a shared facility. How do you get sharing? Because I want to give the best education to everyone. I don't have money to give it in the number of schools I have. In fact, this morning's paper again talks about, is it 25 or 30% schools don't have electricity. In fact, we also had a little problem here just now. Electricity is not easy to get. And in those places, they don't have a generator which immediately steps in. So you don't have it. So what do you do? And what we felt was that if I can afford something per child, let us say I give everyone. Suppose I want everyone to use a computer. In some schools, maybe they can afford every child to have a computer. In some classes, they'll say, no, we will have some common ones for a class. Or maybe there's one computer room in the whole school. Suppose even that is not possible. Then we say, OK, let us take this whole area of South Bangalore, and let us have a center there which will have a computer center, and so on and so forth. So we can keep on going through a different models of sharing. Community Science Center is one such area where there is a wonderful lab-based program. And any school can just enroll and book time on a basis of shared facility. So one of the other things which we have to look at when I'm talking about changing the paradigm is that what we considered can be only in one classroom can be shared. I mean, the car is a very example of the Uber or something. That how much time is the facility used? So you might find that I have an auditorium, but that auditorium is only used for, let's say, 5 hours in the whole week. Then should I have an auditorium myself or should I share it? Most school buildings are in a 24-hour cycle, are empty. Should the schools in the evening become adult learning centers, or should they become something else? So when we are short of resources, can we think differently? Can we think in terms of sharing in a completely different way? But sharing also comes now, again, using the IT example. There is one professor everyone wants to hear. Best professor talking about a particular concept in physics. Can I not share it? This talk, I believe, is being streamed. Someone else can listen to it. It's being recorded. So someone else can listen to it. Cannot the best teachers in India, their talks be easily available? Now, some of them are. Some of them are. But today, being able to learn yourself. So all these models of sharing are available. I might not get credit currently on some of those, but you might work out a model where you can. The relationship with the community I've already talked about. Lot of outreach projects which we do, we go out to them and involve self-help groups and others. In the next slide, I'm going to tell you how, for instance, we are doing it. We do a program called Sanjeevani, where we make schools do medicinal gardens. And they do it, but the question is, who knows about the medicinal garden? Who knows about something? And it's usually the vaid in the village who knows more than anyone here. So we call that person in, so that the community knowledge comes into the classroom. But even if you take the normal assumption, you go to a school and ask the question, who taught you about how plants grow? My science teacher. Is there anyone else in your school who knows about this? They say, no, I think she knows the best. And I say, how about the gardener? So they said, yeah, but he's not a teacher, you know. But in fact, the gardener knows far more about that particular thing than maybe the science teacher does. But because the gardener is not a teacher, we don't do it. So how do you break that? How do you get people in your environment to come and talk? Can the guy downstairs in the canteen, can I find out one thing he would tell you which you don't know? And I'm sure there are many things the person knows which you don't know, which are relevant to your subject. Can we just bring that guy up one day and say, aap boliye, you know, you say something. And this is what this program is do. We had, in fact, we've got a book, which some of you can see. It's called Parampara, India's Culture of Climate-Friendly Practices. There are many Indian practices which need to be seen differently. And I'm going to end that lecture with this. But how the way you see something has to start changing. We do a number of campaigns, education campaigns. We have mobile facilities which go out. But one of the biggest such thing which we did in Shared was the Science Express. It's a train. 8 coaches are an exhibit. It's been seen by over 1 crore of people now. And we did a study. The last edition was on climate change. In classrooms where one class, one division had gone to the Science Express, the other had not. Everything else being the same, there was a 30% increase in the knowledge of climate change. And that happened because they went through this, but then they followed it up. Again, an example of a shared facility. And we know today how the whole concept of sharing is very much part of our modern thinking. The whole IT world has changed. I mean, today, geography can be taught very differently. We are doing some interesting experiments, how you can really bring Google into your maps into your classroom. And how do you change it? But it's not only Google Maps. There's so many other ways how people take, school children take photographs, send it today in WhatsApp and other things. So there's a whole lot of things happening today. We are trying to get people to work on sustainable campuses. And by that, we mean all of that. But here, what is interesting is that there is a measurement. Electricity is the easiest to measure. That the students do a campaign and saying, we will save so much electricity if we do that. In fact, even I was studying at MIT, even there, I remember in those days, a very simple campaign which said switch off. There was a sticker which said switch off. And they had stuck it on every switch in the whole MIT campus. And they had found how much electricity just saved through that little bit of education, communication, whatever you call it. Just the fact that you see that switch off and you do it. So there are many ways in which this can be done and also can be measured. And I think this is another important part that people want to see measurements of what they're doing. We've already talked about interacting with the community. But I wanted to say how the handprint leads to positive action. And I'm going to show you a photograph which came to me last night from one of my colleagues. This is Madhura Dongre. She's daughter of Sujit, who is our colleague in this thing. So they go to this particular restaurant. You can't really read it too much here. And they have a paper, not a menu, the mat, the paper mat. So every time she sees this paper mat. So this time, she has written here in this, you can't really read it properly. She said, why are you using so much paper wasted? Why don't you have a regular mat, et cetera, et cetera. And she goes up to the manager, who really appreciated it. And he said, next time you come, I will have changed it. And it's a small thing. It's a small thing, but she felt empowered enough to sort of do that. And if you see the amount of such stories you will have is enormous. But the people are feeling that they can change. Now you can't change climate change all over the world, but the fact that a little kid feels that I went into a restaurant, I wrote something and it changed. And even in our lives, if we see those examples, we will feel really proud. Today, the world of sustainable development has been defined. 2015, the UNESCO came into it, and I think each of these goals are now being needs to be reflected in our curriculum. So when we're looking at sustainable development, what we are saying is that obviously policy is important and legal mechanisms are important and technology and systems and financial mechanisms, sometimes enforcement. But ultimately, if you don't have education and communication, it doesn't work. And I give sometimes the example of the fact that at sea, people were not wearing their helmet. And we had lost a colleague at Coimbatore, a young girl who fell off a bike. So we made it compulsory, but people are still flouting the rules. So we said we will give them, they can take a soft loan and buy a helmet. Still nothing was happening. Then I made a rule that in our campus, that you cannot enter the campus if you don't wear a helmet. You know, so you have to park outside. The whole idea was that if you don't care for your head, why are you bothered about the helmet? So every day when you came, you saw some scooters outside. And but slowly that disappeared. Everyone knew that they have to wear the helmet. So I said, maybe education is not the whole story. Maybe these things are more impact than education. Then I was driving by and I saw one of my colleagues in front without a helmet. So I said, I must tell him as soon as I go there. So as he approached our campus, he pulls out the helmet, wears it. So what happens is that without this, some of these things are completely missed. Another colleague, I said, why were you not wearing a helmet? He said, sir, it was Sunday. So the point is that the helmet is for your head. It's not a ticket to enter the gate. It is a helmet. It's for your head. You know, but how do you get that? So this is the backbone of the whole thing. But ultimately, as I said, we need to start looking at something fresh, like the beard I was telling you about or something else. Someone was asked in a seminar, do they use solar energy in India? So this guy next to me, another Indian, he said, no, sir, we are not using much solar energy. You know, at that time, I said, how do you think every mirchi is dried in India? You know, now, if I were to have a PV cell at my roof, and then a very efficient dryer, and put the mirchi inside, they'll say solar energy. But if I put it in this, and it is Sida solar, as I call it, Sida solar energy, it is not solar energy. How do you think 99% of clothes are dried in India? Is it through wind energy and solar energy, or is it something else? It is, and what is the instrument? It's a piece of string. You know, I put a string and I put it on it, and that is solar energy. Now, in those countries where you don't see it, I can understand. But it's just a mental thing that this we don't see solar energy. You know, when talking about recycling and everything else, when the gold rush happened in America, in San Francisco, there was this Armenian migrant, I think it was Armenian, migrant who said that, look, everything is tearing and everything else. What do we do? Clothes, you know, very difficult to get. Right? So he took this parachute material, I think, or something and made, or some other material, he made this thing, and that was called the jeans. You know, he made the jeans. And then there was another guy who came and made the rivet. And it was those two collaboration which made what we now call the jeans. And what was so powerful about it was that even if it gussled and it became all old, it still looked good. So now for a designer, it's a real problem, right? Because your old things also are looking good. You don't change the thing, you don't wear. So how do I do it? You know, it is very difficult. So what do they invent? They invent a pre-gussled jeans. Now, I'm saying, what is the whole concept of that was something which lasts long. And incidentally, I also bought one of these. So don't say I'm criticizing anyone. I also bought it. But it is a pre-done deal. So I went, in fact, I went and I made an appeal to Levi's. I said, what you should do is get new jeans made, which in any case comes out of usually Indian material. You give it to students in India, brand new Levi's, no thing. We will wear it for 2-3 years. We will wash it and sell it to you back in America. We can even put a tag that this was worn by so-and-so. It was torn in this adventure, torn in this nature club. And that would be a probably environmental way of handling the problem. You know, why do you want to do it? But what I'm saying is that the very concept of the genes, this looks nice. I mean, I also do it, so I'm not criticizing it. But the very concept that you manage to sell something which, even if it is torn, is good, now you get someone else to tear it, you know, and that also through a machine using so much electricity. So this is how our mindset works, and what we need when we are looking at development is we need to free ourselves from that. One of the things which we do is through our global learning programs, where people from two different cultures meet, because they ask you that fresh questions. Some of this all gets into academics. We have our own journalists, and I was just into a library. Your library gets this journal. It writes about some of this material from all over the world. And so finally, when we talk to people, we this is our message. We said, increase your handprint and decrease your footprint. This is what we go forward with. It's a message which comes out of Shrija and her classmates, 10-year-olds in St. Mary's, Hyderabad, but gone all over the world. One of the only concepts like that. And I think our education system has to get us to be innovative, to take everything from abroad, to understand all that, understand our own traditions, as I said, but finally have our minds such that we can take decisions which are bold, which are new, and which can ask questions without fearing that I'll be laughed at. And that is where we need to go. Thank you very much for this patient hearing. We can take some questions, comments, anything. There's one there, yeah.
Hi, sir. So my question is that, it's a really good and it's super amazing that we're trying to inculcate sustainable way of learning and the whole idea of sustainable development in a curricula for students. My worry is, on the other hand, though, that, what if it becomes it follows the same process of learning, say, mathematics, the way we learn in schools. So, the whole idea of rote learning and, in the future, losing that passion of making a change towards the environment. What if we lose that in the process of inculcating this idea in a curricula and the formal education?
Yeah, so as I mentioned in two or three instances, that it is not the data which is important, because the solution can be different for different places. We were asked to look at an electric bike, for instance, in Ahmedabad. And someone said, can you endorse this bike? Now, in Ahmedabad, the electric bike, if it has to be powered or recharged through the coal-powered power station, which has no spare capacity, then, in fact, we calculated that it's worse for the environment than the petrol scooter. The same bike in some other place might be the correct solution. So the first thing which I think our school needs to understand, that some of these things are contextual. What is right and wrong is contextual. In fact, a large part of Indian philosophy is that. Large part of Indian philosophy is that truth and things are contextual. So someone who I met in this, when she was introducing me, she said I was part of the Earth Charter. In the Earth Charter, there's one Inuit lady. Inuit is the Eskimo lady. And they were arguing for being able to hunt the whale. And there's this vegetarian Indian lady who supported her and at the same time opposed the Japanese fleets from killing the whale. Now, is whale killing good or not? So they said, yeah, for that one it is correct, for this one it is wrong. Now that concept that what is correct and what is wrong is contextual is very difficult most places in the world. But in India, I think most people understand how things need to be different. Now that atmosphere has to go into the school system, that what is correct and what is wrong, and not stop them. So if environment becomes another mantra, it becomes a wrong thing. We were also part of the group in India which had to decide whether environment should be another subject or not. And there was a lot of debate. So is it infused into all the subjects or is it a separate paper? And we have been opposed to having it as a separate paper because then it might do exactly what you're saying. We said it is a way of approaching any paper. It's a way of looking at science. The way if there's a chapter on DDT, I want to be able to ask questions. And none of those substances are bad. They're bad in the way they are used because there might be some other place they might be correct. So that fear is there. That if the environment finally becomes A, B, C, D, which I mug up, then you've lost it. Anything else?
Hello, sir. Sir, you gave the example of sari as a tool and which can be worn in different style in different places. So that was in, I suppose, that was in regard with the content or curriculum or a pedagogy, which, and you want to say that there can be a main baseline thing and that can be designed as per the need of the place and area. So this, I suppose, this gives the autonomy of a teacher or a facilitator who is. So I just want to understand how much easier or how much difficult is doing this in this way.
Well, there are two difficulties. And interestingly, one difficulty is more than another. One difficulty is in knowing how to do options. That is one difficulty. Do I know how else I can use it? The easiest way of understanding it is just take any vegetable in India and see how many ways it is cooked. And you will find that, the sari is one example. It could be a potato also. I could have taken a potato example or any other example. We have even between two households nearby, they will probably cook their dal differently. So we understand that it's not that there is only one recipe. We know this is one recipe, but there is another recipe. And there is it a right recipe or a wrong recipe? The concept in India is yet, luckily, not there so much. That this is the only way you can make this thing. This is the only way dosa can be made. No, there is a book which says 100 ways of making dosa. Right? There is every one. So one is that. The bigger problem is in people's minds. That they themselves don't have the concept of how to do it. I'll give you an example. I was working at the Community Science Center, and there was an experiment to be done. Simple experiment. It said you take a glass, fill it with water. Then you take a dropper, and you keep on adding drops of water. And you will see that the water doesn't spill because of surface tension. It becomes convex, and it stays. Simple experiment. So then I did a survey. How many people who had read our experiment had done it? And you know, I was surprised that so many of them had not done it. They said, "Sir, dropper nahi hai mere paas. Dropper nahi hai." Someone said, "Ki bhai, maine principal ko likha hai ki ek dropper chahiye." Now the point only was ki we had to add water drop by drop. I could have taken my hand also and dropped water. I could have taken a piece of cotton and dropped water. But because I said, "Ki aapko ye experiment karne ke liye dropper chahiye, aur dropper nahi hai mere paas, isliye maine experiment nahi kiya." Okay, now that is the bigger problem, that the teacher must know that they are empowered, and which is why I'm saying that our green teacher course is not actually teaching them something which they don't know. It's just breaking their mindset, ye bhi kar sakte, ye bhi, ye isme mana nahi hai, you know. Now that is also very difficult. So when it says, because all the curriculum writers write, you know, take a stick. How long shall I take a stick? Why, kuch bhi le lo stick. You know, the whole idea was not that it has to be this much only. So how do you get that confidence building in the teacher? So that is the bigger thing. So, but we have found that if you do our program, yes, you will have that confidence. There's a technique how you do it, but you have to do it. You have a question over here? Yeah.
Hello. Is the mic working?
Yeah.
You mentioned a very interesting way of learning or teaching through excellence or mastery, that gardener teaching a plant or a carpenter teaching how to use the... So is it a way that you are focusing teaching through the excellence or achieving mastery in the subject that the child is learning? If yes, what will be the role of teacher in it?
Yeah. First of all, in many cases, what... much of modern literature is not my great idea. In much of modern literature will say that the teacher's role is very much a facilitator role rather than because earlier the teacher's role was also to store knowledge, bring it and give it. Now that role has changed. Facilitator will even mean mastery from there. Very good example was that Gandhiji, for instance, believed very strongly that people should learn in their mother tongue. And this is what he strongly believed. People at the primary level. Afterwards, you can learn in different things, but at the primary level, you learn in mother tongue. So in the Phoenix farm, when he was there in South Africa, this person who runs the farm comes to him and says, sir, there are all these children, their mother tongue is Telugu, but there is no Telugu teacher. So what do we do? So he said, I will take the class. Okay. So he runs this Telugu class, not knowing any Telugu. But someone would say that you would say, okay, this is a, whatever, this is a light, or the light, this is the sun. And I say, okay, who knows? Obviously, there's someone who knows more than that. And he could facilitate a class. And I was just thinking, look at that man in those days without the same words, without the word facilitator written, was facilitating a class which he didn't even know. The thing is, but it does something else. It also breaks this class that only so-and-so is a teacher. That it makes me humble when I have to learn from someone else. So just look at, if you see the people who are around you, and see some people who you have never talked to, they might be always there. The lady who washes the dishes comes 1 hour at my place and washes the dishes. Have I ever asked her about her background, or what does she do, or what else? I might never have asked her. I might have told her, yeah, thik nahi hai. And what is her logic? It was like that woman who arranged flowers at our house. She was not important enough for anyone to ask her why she was arranging the flowers in what was considered the ulta direction. Nobody asked her. So the idea of bringing the Mali into the classroom in a school is doing two things. First of all, he knows about it. But more importantly, he's telling me that he is also a knowledge giver. One of the problems, for instance, I'm dealing with, I don't know how to solve it. In one of the villages I was dealing with, we have a son of a potter. Now, at that time, the potter used to make about 5,000 or something. And the child was going to take a office job at some 500 rupees. Today, those same figures are 3,000, 30,000 and maybe 5,000, whatever it is. But he said, I will do anything, but I will not do pottery. Then I was talking to this lady who is from a potter family. He said, Kartikeya, do you know that when these in our community, when they go to get married, the other person will ask, "Kebi, abhi aap mati kaam abhi kar rahe?" Because they know that if he says yes, my daughter will also have to help with the mati kaam. Mitti banane mein women ka role hai. Toh nahi karenge. So abhi that family which has such great talent in making some of the finest pottery is denying that they know that. I had gone and said to the rural development department, the whole NAREGA, Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme, that starts by saying that you go to a village and you look at the unskilled people. So I had asked at that time, ki aapko aisa lag raha hai ki India mein koi unskilled hai? Maine to kabhi dekhe nahi unskilled log kab, aur gaon mein to bilkul nahi dekha unskilled. Shehron mein ho sakti hai, kuch education karke unskilled hoge. Lekin gaon mein to kabhi unskilled nahi hote. Because otherwise they cannot survive. They cannot survive. But I start with that. So what I'm doing is I'm getting a weaver, an entire community of weavers, I'm then getting them to break stone to make a road. You know? I mean, instead that whole weaving community, if I wanted to give them employment, I could give them something with their wove something. Maybe they make tents for jawans. I don't know what they do. I just want to give them money, nahi employment karna hai. But I'm making them make a road. Because this is the problem. So what I'm trying to do by getting the gardener into the classroom is to teach them dignity also. Ki ye aadmi ko bhi maloom hai. We were also asking survey, which is the first bird call? Which is the earliest bird call? Maloom nahi. Who will know? So bolo wo jamadar, at least in theory, stays up the whole night. So that jamadar will know what time the bird will start calling in the morning. So can I give a stopwatch to him, and when I come in the morning, can I ask him, what time did the bird start? Can I correlate it with the sun going up? You know, can I get it? So can I at least talk to people like human beings? Or do I treat them as some other class? So I think there are hidden messages in some of the things which we do.
Hello. Sir, you have an interesting take on education and versus learning. So I just want your views on how do you see education and how do you see learning?
I didn't put education and learning, I put teaching and learning. Teaching and learning. Education mein to dono aati hai, but teaching is something which is in a sense, to some extent, top down. In a classical model, teaching is when I've come with a curriculum and I teach it. Now, one of the problems which happens there is that we have fixed, I mean, there are so many things in the system. You've got a fixed classroom. And you're dealing with a little kid, and the kid has really got involved in this particular thing. Huh? 30 minutes, 45 minutes, whatever your class is, it's finished. Well, no, now you have to leave this work, or you have to go into social studies. Now, the person is getting into the depth of that thing. In any other learning situation, I would have let that child learn it. But our schedules don't permit it. So unless we change structurally the school system, there are many things. I mean, today was not enough time to say, how do I apply this to the school system? How do I do it? I gave one or two examples how very easily, for instance, something which you can also try and do. Just take cross questions in a paper. You will immediately see how interesting it becomes. If I were to be able to mix questions and not keep the question only from that. So we can play around it. Okay, we'll take one last one. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Abraham. I'm from a small town in Andhra near Tirupati. And my children go to a government school, particularly because there's more talent and more spontaneity there. And, we have tried to augment some of it from our learning center. And I see a huge disconnect between two segments of society. One is the ones who have some money and those who don't have. And those who don't have the skill, and those who have uprooted themselves and moved to town areas, living totally disconnected from the rural lifestyle. And children come to schools and they are totally disconnected from the environment. And whereas the government schools are all in their villages and they are close to the environment. But there is no connection between these two systems. And I think there is a solution somewhere in between. And I would like you to enlighten as to if you have done work with this kind of situations before. And I would like to know more about your work there.
Yeah, you're right. I think this cross-cultural, if you can call it, mixing of students into different environments is really important. Schools typically will do it within, if they've got division A, B, C, then the next year they will mix them around, you know, for that same reason. But it's not enough of a mixture, because basically they're all from the same thing. There are other programs like Santosh, for instance, runs the camping activity. Now, a camping activity takes you out into the field. Now, many people who are, strictly speaking, from a poorer background are often much more adept at doing some of these things than others who might never have had to actually do it with their own hands. And they start respecting and seeing how team building activities, sports activities typically, are things where you see it. I think one has to understand that talent is not a single dimensional thing. And often in education, we do it to do that. Someone is artistic, someone has got other skills. So I think recognizing that. And you know, Times of India has a program called Teach India or something they've got. And we got all of our people there and they said, give them something, where they go. I said, when you go into a slum, before you take your opportunity to teach anything, you will learn something. So I'm saying that I'm going to do a soda with you. Okay, I'm coming to give you, I'll tell you something interesting, but you have to teach me something. It could be anything. It could be how you can climb a tree, all you know. It could be something of how you do something else. I don't know what you do. But you have to teach me something which I don't know. And you will be very hard-pressed to find anyone in this room or even outside who doesn't have at least one thing they can teach you which you don't know. You know, but it's a humbling experience that I can also, I might be the top professor anywhere, but there's something I don't know. And I think that is something which we need to know. I must say that American system, there I found when I went from Cambridge in England to MIT, and I happened to spend one afternoon with the vice chancellor equivalent there, Professor Wisdom. The minute he steps out of his cabin when he's the vice chancellor, he is no longer the vice chancellor. He's a regular person. So he stands in queue, he goes outside, he talks to the guy who cleans the car, he does everything else. Here, the sahib becomes a sahib all over, you know. So I carry my sort of whatever it is, I go all over, I'm supposed to be somewhat privileged. And that is, the, in a sense, a recognition that in that garage, the guy who is the boss, if you like, or the guy who knows more is that garage guy. He is not Mr. Vice Chancellor who should say how that should be done. He is the guy. So I think that is not in our system. Our system today puts down hand things, skills which you know with the hand. It basically is an intellectual, that also in certain things, you very soon people will know, I'm no good at mathematics, I'm no good at this. There's no such thing. I really tell parents, you please show me a single child who doesn't know mathematics, I'll personally see that they know it. There is no such, it's just, our system has just put it into their heads that they don't know. So I think there are lots more, I mean, the whole thing can't be discussed just like that. But you yourself will observe it. And I think some of the questions, I think these are all within our own thing. I mean, it will be fascinating for you to write how your children's experiences are different. Just note it down because we forget very fast. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think there are some more questions, but we are out of time. I'm sorry. And I think students are interested to connect both with the CE and some of the points that you raised. This is just a glimpse. They've been working for a number of years. And as you can see, what a engaging sort of presentation, many points for us to think about. Santosh works with the CE. Bangalore, the southern region.
South, he's the coordinator regional coordinator, and you're all welcome to the thing. We'll see that you all get the address of that.
Do come to our campus. It's very near
to America. Yeah, it's fun because we are just starting. We found yesterday that we were in the path of snakes. There's a particular path which the snakes seem to do, so we're trying to figure out how do we keep that path for them.
And we will have the links. Shashwati has also visited CE recently. Mine is a very old association, and I'm happy to renew it. So there'll be many sort of possibilities of, as they said, with interning, with other programs. So keep your questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Kartik bhai. Yeah. Sorry, Harshal. I should also thank Harshal, who is seniors to you. Which batch I forget all these things, but thank you for making this happen as well. Thanks.